technology, IIT Kanpur was the first institute in India to offer computer science engineering. The earliest computer courses were started in IIT Kanpur in August 1963 on IBM 1620 systems.
The entrepreneurship cell of IIT Kanpur aims to foster the spirit of entrepreneurship among the college students and nurture young minds with bright ideas. There are many startups from IIT Kanpur, and to name a few are InMobi, ShareChat, GrabHouse. Some of them have been featured in the Forbes 30 Under 30 list. We are here to water the ideas in the bud and help them bloom into the impactful endeavors. We are here to seed this impact.
I create, I take risks, I have my passion, I am an entrepreneur. That's the vision of eCell, IIT Kanpur.
eCell effectively meets these objectives through networking students from campus to incubators, venture capitalists to angel investors. We host a speaker series of eminent personalities to inspire and invoke the huge potential within the students. We aim to connect with the entrepreneurial leaders and innovators who are the alumni of IIT Kanpur and engage them to foster the same passion and spirit in the current batch of students.
We at eCell want students to solve real-life problems by being the job creators and not just the job seekers. eSummit provides the leading platform and a chance to interact with the leading business tycoons to all those students and professionals who aim to become entrepreneurs.
Now I would like to invite on stage the director, sir, of our institute, Dr. Indraneel Manna, Dean of Resources and Alumni, Dr. B.V. Fenny, for lighting of the lamp ceremony. And also...
Mr. Sanjeev Agarwal, Mr. Farid Asan, and Mr. Pratik Shukla, the four eminent personalities, guests, and above all, our alumni who have made us proud for joining this particular session here today, this evening. I often maintain that science is all about know why, and engineering is exactly know how. The initiative that you are going to discuss today is exactly what we often want, that all our students should learn the bridge between the fundamental science and engineering, or in other words, the translation of know why to know how. We all are aware that engineering is all about providing solution and addressing the aspiration of the nation, of the millions, of the society. If you look around, there are many, many challenges all over the places, and a subset of them, are of engineering origin. In this institute, we being an institute of technology, it is certainly our duty to not only teach about them, but also pursue actively certain domains which eventually will yield results and show us workable solutions. Today in the evening, I was busy reviewing one of our centers, research centers of the institute. Many of you are aware of a group called Flexible Electronics Center. It's actually National Center on Flexible Electronics, in brief, FLEXI. And this was founded about 2 years ago, and within 2 years, they are now able to show number of prototypes, and we believe that there are six different verticals, and we believe each of these verticals are going to produce eventually some commercial products, and certainly many more bench scale demonstration worthy solutions. We have a certain ecosystem in the campus, which is primarily led by the SIDBI Innovation and Incubation Center. This center, you're all aware, promotes both for faculty and students, and even industry from outside to come and work with us together towards creation of specific products. There are success stories. More than 30 companies have been incubated, and larger number are now associated with us. In order to take a bold step and go to the next level of such initiative, the Board of Governors recently, in principle, approved creation of a Section 8 company, a not-for-profit company, out of this Innovation Incubation Center. A few years ago, we were very keen to get lease of a land in Lucknow proper, closer to the airport, and create not only a building, but also an infrastructure which would allow us to, some of these companies which are incubated here, we thought many of them would actually take space there and then go commercial. In the meantime, another initiative was launched by Ministry of Human Resource Development through Department of Science and Technology, which allows certain institutes to create what is known as Research Park. Some of you may be aware that IIT Bombay and IIT Madras already, they have such Research Park. IIT Kanpur made its bid last year, and immediately it was approved. But unfortunately, the sanction amount, 75 crore, is yet to reach us. But I'm told only just a few days back that the financial document has already been approved, and very soon we are likely to get this sum of money. Once we get this, the research park will form a part of our bigger vision, which we want to call a research complex. So one part of the research complex, I think the total estimated cost of the complex is close to 200 crore, will be this research park. So then what's the difference between the incubation center and the research park? In incubation center, we want our students, scholars, faculty members to work together, and we may even get some of our alumni who might get interested and join us in this initiative to create products and processes. Research Park will create the next level of ecosystem where companies who want to access to the intellectual capital of the institute and also have an access to the entire research, characterization, testing, development, infrastructure, and knowledge base available, they can come and sit here and deploy a small group of that company, in other words, can have an extended wing of their research and development center at IIT Kanpur to work with us alongside towards creation of new products and processes. I always also tell my students that we must appreciate the so-called differences between the science, engineering, and technology. I told you the first two parts. In my jargon, they are no why and no how. And the last part, the last mile, is technology, which is no what sells in the market. And in India, while we celebrate the achievements of IIT system in terms of three things, the quality education in engineering and technology, number two, the quality research conducted in institutions, and number three, the products, the alumni. And nobody in the world would dispute about the highest level of quality about these three. What we do not have as yet is our ability to compare ourselves with the contributions made by the likes of Stanford and MIT and Berkeley in terms of number of new companies spawn off the campus. So in order to address that ambition, we now are talking about not just one or two initiatives. We are talking about Innovation and Incubation Center. We are talking about Section 8 company. We are talking about Research Park. And we are talking about creating a culture within the institute and also ingrain that in our curriculum, which will promote entrepreneurship. And this is why exactly we are here this evening. And this is not that we are beginning right now. We began this journey about 6-7 years ago. And there is a very active participation from a section of the faculty. And most of our very bright and young students are extremely passionate about it. And it's only about time before we really see some very good success. So I would urge upon all of you to make the best use of the infrastructure and initiatives that the Institute has created for you and is committed to create or make it even better in days to come. And what we need is to make an impact by virtue of creating a few solutions which will be selling everywhere in the market, bearing the stamp of IIT Kanpur. And when that ambition gets realized, then I'm sure we'll have more reasons to celebrate and feel proud as a leading institute of this nation. So I would again now urge all of you to, I think all of you are actually waiting not to listen to me, but to Dr. Chaudhary and all our very esteemed guests today. And I'm sure they will inspire you and you'll have certain very valuable thoughts from them to take home and latch on to it in future. But let me also warn you something, that unless you have a very strong foundation, don't look at the peak, don't look at the apex. So the fundamentals have to be very strong, and that can come through the curriculum that is pursued in IIT Kanpur, which is celebrated all over. So don't ignore the curriculum, the education, the formal education that is imparted here. Senate already has approved those passionate ones who would like to try it out, venturing into the entrepreneurship space. You could do that by taking a semester or two off. But remember, the foundation has to be strong. So please don't ignore the basic studies that you are supposed to pursue here. And then by all means, pursue your passion in a very directed way. So thank you very much. And let's look forward to very, very illuminating talks this evening. Thank you.
We would like to thank you, sir, for such a motivational and inspirational speech.
Now we have our first talk of the event with Mr. Sanjeev Agrawal. Sanjeev Agrawal is co-founder of the Fundamentum Partnership and Helion Ventures and has served on the boards of Amber Research, Make My Trip, and United Lex. He is currently on the boards of Azure Power, IQ, ShopClues, and Big Basket. Prior to Helion, Mr. Sanjeev was the founder and CEO of Daksh, having been with the company from its inception in 2000 to its acquisition by IBM in 2004. He worked with Digital Equipment Corporation in delivering technology solutions and was recognized as the Decathlon winner, a recognition given to top 1% managers worldwide. He also served as a CEO of 3Com India.
Now, we would like to invite him on the stage to deliver the talk for our audience.
And to some of my brightest colleagues have come from IIT Kanpur. My partner in crime at Helion Ventures is a gentleman called Ashish Gupta, who did his engineering in computer science many, many years back. And so is the case with my partner in my newest venture, which is Fundamentum. So I think I really equate IIT Kanpur with entrepreneurship. So in a way, it is like preaching to the Pope. You guys have produced so many wonderful entrepreneurs across generations that I think this is a very, very apt subject. I must tell you about my own journey. I grew up in Chandigarh and I did my engineering from Punjab Engineering College. And I was telling the director that na to mujhe engineering mein interest tha na medicine mein. So, but I took the one which was a shorter program. Medicine used to take 8 years to pass, while engineering took 4 years. So I did my engineering, but I, at the heart, I wanted to be my own master. And I started a computer training company in 1981. At that point in time, actually NIIT had not started. So we were a pioneer. But my father was actually very aghast with this move because he was a judge. And first he was telling me, ki if you have to do engineering, you have to do civil engineering because that is the only engineering discipline which gets you a government job. So first he thought that I'll pursue civil engineering, and I did electrical. And then he thought that I'll take up a job in government, which I didn't. And I ended up starting a company. And one day I overheard him telling my mother, ki iski shaadi kaise karayenge, ye to apna isne kaam shuru kar liya. Because entrepreneurship was not a very, very respectable thing at the time when I started. So I gave up my stint as an entrepreneur. And then I went on to do my MBA, and I worked for about 20 years before I started my next company, which was in year 2000. Which is related to the area that Mr. Reddy started his company also in, but much earlier than my time. So I think from 81 circa 2017, it's night and day. At that point in time, actually, there were very few jobs in the economy. So the cost of failure was very high. If your venture did not succeed, one, it was difficult to get married, as I told you, so it was a stigma. And two, it was very difficult to get an alternative job. So for a middle class person, this was a very, very difficult adventure. But I think come 2017, the cost of failing as an entrepreneur is almost zero. But the upside is massive. Upside is in terms of impact you can make. Upside is in terms of recognition that you get. And upside is in terms of financial freedom that you get at a very early age, which is very, very empowering and enabling. Money is a very good resource for you to make even more impact. So I think I don't need to tell this group that you and your alumni are actually living in great days. I wish I was born 20 years later. And when we look at prospective entrepreneurs that we want to fund, I think IITians from all over the country are right at the top of the pecking order. So you have a natural advantage that by virtue of your tenacity, intellect, training, you have a huge advantage. So I think that is the case for entrepreneurship, that you have got excellent raw material to turn an entrepreneur. I think the second part of our discussion is that the opportunity that you have in front of you is tremendous. Today, India was independent in 47, so 2007, India took 60 years to turn a $1 trillion economy. Can anybody guess how long it took us to turn into the second trillion? Only 7 years. So we grew from 47 to 2007 into 1 trillion. and second trillion came from 7 to 14, which is 7 years, and third trillion will be even shorter than that. So I think we are actually one of the few fast-growing economies. And more importantly, when we become a 5 trillion GDP, experts believe that about a trillion of that is going to come from digital economy. And digital economy is all about new entrepreneurship, because it's a different way of disrupting industries, be it travel, be it retail, be it transportation. All these industries are getting disrupted in your lifetime. And there is no advantage for incumbents. So therefore, a company which is in transportation is at a handicap to take advantage of technology and internet because of the legacy. So I think you have a huge advantage that you don't have any legacy. I mean, look at all the disruptors around the world. Elon Musk is disrupting automotive industry, but he doesn't have any background in automotive industry. Jeff Bezos did not come from retail. So I think one of your biggest strength is that you have no legacy, you have no baggage, and you are in times when at least $1 trillion of GDP will get created through new technologies, where incumbents have a very, very serious disadvantage. And if you see all the players who are disrupting these industries, whether it is Flipkart disrupting retail, or Ola disrupting transportation, or Make My Trip disrupting travel, these are all young entrepreneurs in your age bracket. In fact, in our industry, if you are beyond 35, you are not fundable. So I think you have a tremendous leg up in riding the digital economy wave, which is unfolding as we speak. And the second point I would like to make is that there are so many unique India problems. India has one of the highest infant mortality rate. I think, I don't know whether you guys have done any research on this. All the brain is formed within first 3 years. And a large part of our youngsters are getting brain damaged because they are not getting the appropriate nutrition in those early years. Skilling. I think we have a lot of education, but we don't have talent which can work in the industry. Energy. There is a transition going on from coal to solar. So I think big transition that all of you can capture. So I think on one hand, you have a great asset, which is your education, your intellect, your professors, your peers. Two, you are blessed that you are living in a country in the right time at the right place, where we are going through an explosive GDP growth. And I think these two things together create a very nice ingredient for turning an entrepreneur, if that is your passion. So I think that is where I was making a case that many of you, as one of the speakers said, should become job creators rather than job seekers. And I think if you see last few years in our economy, we've had a jobless GDP growth. So the solution lies in this room, where many of you can create jobs by turning entrepreneurs. And now I'll speak for a few minutes, if I may, on what are some of my lessons learned around building companies and investing in companies. One of my lessons is that entrepreneurship is a team sport, that you will always find in most situations that there are multiple people involved in building great company. I call it the Brahma and Vishnu. Brahma is the one who is the forward-looking creator, thinker, and Vishnu is the one who is the operator. So I think when the Brahma and Vishnu come together, wonderful things happen. So I think that is one very interesting ingredient of entrepreneurship, that it's a team sport. And you have such a big advantage being in this campus of working with your colleagues, seniors, ex-alums. The second thing that I learned around entrepreneurship, that it's all about delayed gratification. I think one thing where India is still a question mark is we are a good startup nation, but we don't know whether we are a good scale-up nation. Because sometimes we run out of stamina very, very quickly. So I think as you think of building companies, think about deferred gratification. Think of yourself not as a sprinter, but as a marathon runner. The third piece that comes to my mind is that a lot of youngsters are very bright and build great task-oriented companies, but very few companies are building the soul. I think one of the failures that is happening currently in the West is Uber, which is, I'm sure you've all tracked that company, which is a $60 billion company, but as director mentioned, has very fragile foundation. And foundations are built on culture, building a soul, on which institutions become long-lasting. So I think thinking about that as you think of building a company, you want to keep in mind. Infosys would be a great example of company with a soul. And my last point is that one very simple formula for building a great company is maniacal focus on customer satisfaction. And look no farther than Amazon, which will bend itself backwards to serve a customer. So I think these are some of my lessons that I've learned over many years as an entrepreneur and backing young entrepreneurs. And I'm sure that this group will create wonderful companies like has happened in the prior years from IIT Kanpur. Thank you very much.
Pratik Shukla, co-founder and CEO of GrabHouse, is an alumnus of IIT Kanpur 2012. GrabHouse is a platform where you can get flat and PG for rent without brokers. GrabHouse is a full-fledged rental platform and aims to establish the direct connection between the owners and the tenants with all the information of the house and neighborhood in double rooms. It provides you a lot of options with location and amenities.
We would like to invite the speaker on the stage now. Can the speaker arise?
We are sorry. Actually, there is some delay. So we are proceeding with the next session. For this, we would like to call Mr. B.V.R. Mohan Reddy. Let me first introduce our speaker.
B.V.R. Mohan Reddy is an Indian business executive and engineering manager who is the CEO of Cyient and the chairman of IIT Hyderabad. He joined DCM Group initially and has worked subsequently with Micro Bosch, HCL and OMC Computers Limited. He was the chairman of NASSCOM for 2014 to 2015. He is also associated with councils of various academic and industrial forums and has led to several initiatives which will help industrial companies to evolve and grow.
Now, sir, we would like to invite you on the stage to start off with the session.
Good evening. I'm glad there are a lot of people around still in the hall. So thank you for inviting me for this evening. It's 4 minutes past 8 o'clock. So what stands between you and your dinner is me. So actually it's about in the recent past, I was doing an event in Kuala Lumpur, where the organizers told me that, Mr. Reddy, the dinner, you're the pre-dinner speaker. You need to get to the restaurant at, it was at Petronas Tower. So they gave me the address, and I got a cab, and got into the cab and was driving to the dinner. And so I made a conversation with the cab driver, and the cab driver asked me, I said, Petronas Tower. So he said, well, what are you doing there? I said, I was going to this restaurant. He said, oh my God, that's the best Italian restaurant in town. And so what are you planning to do there? So I said, you know, look, people invited me for lecture. He said, better do a good job. I drive a lot of people to this restaurant. And after the dinner, most of the people tell me the food was great, but the speaker was lousy. So literally after that, I found it extremely challenging to be a pre-dinner speaker. But back again, the entrepreneur in me said, no, you never give up. So I'll try my best one more time to see if I can probably still keep you, keep your attention before you get to your dinner. I come from the city of Hyderabad. It's not easy to get connected into Kanpur. I woke up at about 4:30 in the morning to be here with you this evening. As I age, I get a little more restless in getting to sleep. But that's probably the reason why people say old people don't sleep for too long. All the same, I'm still live and kicking. But I'm extremely nostalgic whenever I come to your campus. It was 45 years back, the first time I came to this campus as a student. And thereafter, my life completely changed. I'm sure, except maybe one, two, a few, I can probably count now, and none of you were even born when I came to IIT Kanpur. That was in December of 1971. I started in January of, that's when I came for an interview. In January of 1972 is when I got started. Tremendous amount of impact this institution had on me. Truly so, the first prime minister of this country called this institute as a temple of learning. That's how I feel so good whenever I come here. I saw infrastructure which was world class. It was just about 10 years since the campus got started off. I met with professors who were just nothing but outstanding. And I never had a dull moment in my life while I was in this campus. But more interestingly, for the first time I saw the computers. The young lady talked about the computer science department being started in the institute being started in 1963, I guess, or 61, she said. And the first computer was an IBM 1620. So by the time I came to the campus, we still had the IBM 1620, but it got added by two more computers, an IBM 1401 and IBM 7044. I was with Professor Prabhakar from the computer department a little while earlier. I said, Professor Prabhakar, I just wanted to hear what is there in the computer center these days. He said, Mr. Reddy, I don't even know what is there. That's how the computers have become now, but that's when the computers were. We're saying this was the best computer center in the country. So the moment I learned all about computers, my life changed. My life had, the institute had a profound impact on my life. I think, yet another character, and you'll hear something very similar between two entrepreneurs, Sanjeev and me. He talked about one of the key things about entrepreneurship is teamwork. And certainly that is what I think I learned in this campus too, in addition to all about computers. What I keep calling it as competitive cooperation. Like hell, people used to compete with each other in the class. But if I didn't know something, I went to my next room. I used to be in hall 5. C202, I still remember. I could go to somebody in C201 and ask him a question about it. He would, as passionately as he would know, he would explain to me what the concept was. That's what this institute taught to me. Certainly, I think the third one, and I'll stop there, many more things I can talk about more passionately of what the institute taught me, is the flexibility in terms of what you could do in life. The department was mechanical engineering. My specialization was industrial engineering. But the first time I thought there was so much amount of flexibility, I did courses in econometrics. There was a gentleman called Potluri M. Rao. I used to know him till very recently. And I did a course in material science. Today, the fact that that flexibility comes back into the education system certainly gives us flexibility in terms of developing ourselves very laterally. So extremely blessed people you are. Some of you are studying here. Some of you are visiting this particular campus. And God bless all of you. Let me move on to the more serious part of what I wanted to share with you is that is all about the e-summit, the Indian Entrepreneurship Summit. And let me share a few thoughts with you. The first and the foremost is, I think the need for entrepreneurship is enormous in this country. Today, I don't know whether you're familiar with this, 1 million people are ready seeking jobs every month in this country. That's the number of people who come for jobs. In a year, approximately, it's 10 million. And the way in which the demography of this country is, that will happen at least for 10 more years. Which means that you've got to create 100 million jobs in the course of next 10 years. And one statistic which has been extremely well documented around the world is that 60 to 70% of jobs in the Western world get created only by startups and small companies. The large established players create fewer jobs compared to the newer companies. So therefore, it's the imperative need that we have to have in making sure we'll have more amount of entrepreneurs, and more importantly, we create a funnel of entrepreneurs so that some succeed. We'll come to that as we move forward. But those who will not even succeed will have other opportunities, all right. But interestingly, the small become the big of tomorrow. So there is an extremely high priority in terms of creating entrepreneurship because the need for jobs. So also we see that the GDP growth, which Sanjeev talked about, it took us 60 years to create the first $1 trillion. It took 7 years to get the second $7 trillion. It might take 3 years, I believe, to get the third $1 trillion. That's the pace at which we are creating our economic growth. That can happen only when there is more amount of industrial activity. And that industrial activity will only will come through entrepreneurship. And the third reason, I have the power of three ideas, is that we need to create more amount of entrepreneurship because it will bring about social equity. We'll come to some of those technologies in a moment, but these technologies today that we will talk about are the ones which are trying to level off people, whether it is healthcare, whether it's education, whether it is agriculture. All of them are easily accessible to people and through newer entrepreneurs who are coming in. So I think the first point I wanted to make was entrepreneurship is something which is the need of the hour, urgent need of the hour. That's how we are talking about Startup India. The second one is we are very fortunate people. You're born at a point of time when technology is at its best. If you look at the mankind itself, mankind went through series of changes all through their lives. And as a result of that, I keep saying that, you know, mankind and change are synonymous with each other. When mankind was born, change also came by. But interestingly, if you look at then how technology played a role in making sure that the well-being of the mankind improved, and also that the economic level uplifted with nations, they were clearly defined as different industrial revolutions that happened. But more interestingly, before I get to the industrial revolutions, if you look at the technology impact that happened on human life itself, if you go back 200 years, I believe in the number was in 1820. 1820, the average lifespan of a human being was 35 years. The average lifespan in 2017 for human beings is at 70 plus years. 200 years of research expanded the lifespan of human beings by 35 years. 6 years of research is leading to 1 year extension in life. I'll leave it to your imagination what happens when 1 year of research will then lead into 1 year of expansion in life. But back into technology, is that we said we had first industrial revolution, which was more to do with mechanization. Then you got into a mode where the second industrial revolution, which was led by Henry Ford, which was to do with a more amount of assembly line. And then the third industrial revolution was with ICT technologies. But thereafter, if you look at it, people have not had so much courage to talk about the fourth industrial revolution. Why? Because every day there's a revolution. Every day there's a breakthrough in terms of technology. Every day there's a new technology that comes in which disrupts the existing technologies. So while you probably can think about, oh my God, what is Mr. Reddy talking about today? He's talking about so much of disruption, so how do I cope with it? You have the advantage that with this challenge comes an opportunity. Newer technologies are challenging for people who are existential. People like us who have been in business for a long time have challenges with us. But people who want to start afresh, you don't have the baggage to carry with you. I think Sanjeev talked about the baggage too. So therefore, you have many more opportunities in terms of becoming an entrepreneur. So these disruptions are creating enormous number of opportunities. And look at any of those technologies, whether it is Mac, social, mobility, analytics, cloud, or you're talking about AR, VR, MR, I believe, augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, or you're looking at artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning. All of these, if you lead them into it, what is the end of it is that if you then think about them, it's your imagination is the only limitation, in my view, which makes you think a solution with these technologies. And these technologies today, in addition to that, what we are seeing is that the world is becoming very interconnected. When our fixed lines were there, there were no more than about 1 billion people who were connected together. When mobility came into existence, then we said there are 2 billion people who are connected. With now Internet of Things, with Internet everywhere, by 2020, the predictions are there will be 20 billion people and things will start talking to each other. So that is yet another phenomena which creates more amount of opportunities. We are seeing yet another opportunity, which I think we talked about a few minutes back, is the amount of GDP growth that's happening in the developing world, adding $1 trillion in 3 years. And so therefore, the emerging economies are becoming much more stronger. And certainly, I think one other phenomena that we're seeing is there's aging population in some countries, which does provide more opportunities for people like you in India. This particular technology, according to me, is also getting very further amplified because we still continue to see the cost reduction in technologies. Gordon Moore in 1974 talked about all about this Moore's law. He said the density of resistors or capacitors on a semiconductor will double itself in every 18 months. The cost of the chip will come down by half every 18 months. He said the size of the chip will become half every 18 months. In 1974, people said Gordon Moore was crazy. It could never happen. Fast forward, in 1994, people reviewed and said, still, Gordon Moore was wrong. Why? Because it was not taking 18 months any longer. It was taking less than 18 months to get this phenomena going. But we think even in 2017, it's the same phenomena that occurs. The cost is coming down. The speed is going up. Size is coming down. So as a result of that, you see that computing power, storage, and the sensors are becoming cheap, faster, and also they're becoming smaller. The second phenomena that is amplifying is that technology today is not limited to just your home, not to your street. It's globalized. And the third one is that you also see that people are getting more and more comfortable with technology. My little granddaughter, who is 4 years now, but I saw her at 2 years old, when she started looking at pinching of her TV screen to see if the image can get expanded. So that's the familiarity. I never would understand what pinching is till probably I was 60 years. And you'll also see that people are seeing tremendous amount of competitive advantage in using technologies. And finally, there is a multiplier effect of technology. Sanjeev talked about Uber as an example. That's all at the top of most of our minds. But look at Uber. What's Uber? It's not a taxi company. It's a taxi aggregator, you can call it. Or you can say it's a platform. It brings in the people who are wanting to have a ride, with the drivers who are absolutely idle at that point of time. But that's one technology that we put together. But look at one more technology, which is one of the company called Paytm. It's a fintech company. But fintech company and the Uber platform are in conjunction with each other, growing rapidly. Without Paytm, Uber would not have been what it is. Or without Uber, Paytm would not have been as it is. So there is an amplification that is happening because of the technology intersections that are happening around the world in different areas. Let's move on to the third part of what I wanted to talk to you. What are the lessons I learned in my life? It's a fairly long journey of mine, 45 years since I first stepped into IIT Kanpur, 43 years since I graduated from IIT Kanpur. But I think, you know, 25, 26 years since I've been an entrepreneur. That's how old my company is. And so what are the few lessons that I learned? I wouldn't spend too much of time, but let me share what I can with you. Number one is, if you want to become an entrepreneur, please identify a real existential problem. Don't hypothetically think there's a problem somewhere, I want to go and solve that problem. A problem has to be a real problem that you want to solve. Don't think about hypothetically, I'm going to create employment, so therefore I want to become an entrepreneur. I want to become rich, I want to become an entrepreneur. That's not what entrepreneurs dream for. Step one, therefore, look for an existential problem. I want to serve food for all the people in city of Kanpur. Man, there are already 20 people who are doing that. You'll be the 21st guy. So that's not an existential problem. It's not a problem which is in existence at this point of time. So therefore, the first thing that I learned was identify a real problem. I found a real problem in providing engineering as a service to the Western world. People were already doing IT services when I started my business. But nobody was doing engineering. Engineering had the same similar challenge. There were challenges in terms of capacity in the Western world. They had challenges in having capable people. They also had challenges in making sure that the costs were under control. So we combine all these three things together, the cost, capability, and the capacity, and found a solution to it, which is a global delivery model, through which we said, as much as IT was delivered, we could also design subsystems and systems for Airbus, Boeing, or it is Pratt & Whitney, or look at any of those heavy equipment manufacturers like Caterpillar or John Deere, or you look at telecom companies, whether it's Telstra, or it is AT&T, or it's British Telecom, and so on and so forth. So therefore, the first is the problem should be in existence, a real problem, and you should find a solution to it. That's the second step for becoming an entrepreneur. To me, a third step that's further down there is that please make money. Don't give the story that I'm not going to be making money. Then you're not going to be an entrepreneur. My customers love me because I make money. I'll be absolutely brutally honest about it. Because customers work with you. I mean, one guy who buys some small product and goes away, it's fine. But if the customer wants to have a long-term relationship, they want people to make money. And you will never succeed if you don't make money. So therefore, we put into play a model which we called it as PSPDI. Our business has to be profitable all the time. It has to be de-risked. It has to be predictable. It has to be sustainable. And we have to have innovation built into it. So only then you will see that companies will then become sustainable. Because you're not here to become an entrepreneur, to do a work for just one day. Just make 1,000 rupees at the end, 1 lakh rupees in a month, 20 lakhs in a year, or at 2 crores for that matter. If you want to truly become an entrepreneur, think about a business model which will sustain itself, which then obviously leads that the market has to be large. And as you start grounding yourself, you should start making the market larger and larger. We started with our geography was just United States, North America. Geographically, we started distributing ourselves. It became North America, it became Europe, it became Southeast Asia, largely Australia, and thereafter Japan. So we had one service offering, which is probably to do with just engineering of parts. But thereafter, it became just not engineering, it could be reverse engineering. It could be manufacturing support. It could be to do with aftermarket support, aftermarket engineering. There could be a number of service offerings. So constantly, entrepreneurs look for expanding the markets that they have. And lastly, the other point which is important is please make sure you have enough money every time that you are in business. You are in desperate need of money, nobody will give you. I'm looking at Sanjeev right now, because he knows much more experience with his funded companies. Because that has been, I'm sure it's his experience too. Why would I go and fund somebody who is in desperation at this point of time? I like to go and fund companies which are healthy. So therefore, I raised money whenever I did not really need it. When I'm doing very well, I raised money so that you build a healthy company. So these are about 5 or 6 cardinal principles, I think, you as entrepreneurs should keep in mind. Make sure you have a real problem, you have a solution to the problem, you are profitable, you've got a large marketplace, you're funded well. Of course, no denying, no issues at all in saying you should be a visionary leader. What is a visionary leader? Who is a visionary leader? Go and do a Google search. It'll tell you people who can see something which other people can't see. But that's how the entrepreneurs are defined as. And certainly, I think you need to have that passion, enormous amount of hard work. And people say, Mohan, you were lucky. I don't dispute that at all, but I became lucky after working very hard. So luck will come and smile only on people who work hard. So don't compromise on the hard work. Let me move on to the last but one topic that I had is, what is the entrepreneurial ecosystem at this point of time? I think, again, as much as I said, you are very lucky people that you're born at a point of time that technology is at its best. Every day there's a new technology, a new opportunity that comes by. So is the ecosystem today. For people like me, we never heard about this word called entrepreneurship so intensely as what all of you are hearing today. I never was not in an e-fest or an e-summit like this at any point of time. I get invited at least for 6 events every month. I feel very delighted about it. Not that I'm going to all of them. I get to probably one at the most in every month. But the fact is that there is so much amount of awareness that's being created. Start from Professor Indraneel Mandan was talking about it, what the IIT campus is doing in terms of promoting more amount of entrepreneurship. The innovation center, the incubation center, summits of this nature. You're talking about the research park. All these are good things for you, and I like to certainly urge all of you to make sure that you use these facilities intensely so that your ideas could be much more robust. We also have seen the ecosystem getting much more robust with having innovation labs. And also what we see is that there have been large incubation centers that have been created in the recent past. Look at them more intensely. I've been instrumental in creating one in Hyderabad. It's called the T-Hub. It's considered to be the largest incubation center in the country today. Amazing results that we have produced. A 100,000 square feet building, that's physical infrastructure, all right. Incubating about 900 companies which are registered with us. 160 companies physically there. Doing amazingly good deep tech work. And more importantly, we've got enough of mentors working with them. We got the support services, which are there 24/7. We are helping them with market access and also fundraising. So therefore, I think good reason for all of you to believe that you should become entrepreneurs, because it's not just the opportunity, but also the ecosystem is extremely strong as we speak. Finally, the last topic on which I wanted to comment on is people say, oh no, entrepreneurship is all about risks. So therefore, what happens to us if we fail? I think more than failing, I think all of us suffer from one thing, is the fear of failure. A good example is me alone. I wanted to be an entrepreneur a couple of times. I never attempted to do it full-fledged. Finally, I jumped into it when I went past 40 years. I was 41 years when I became an entrepreneur. So I'm a very strange breed of people. I'm no more like many of you in this room who are the sub-20s or 20-year-olds who who could take risk. At 41, I had two school-going children, a family to take care of, but certainly I put a strategy in place to make sure I still wanted to take those risks. More than actually the risks in entrepreneurship, I think the fear of failure of the society is fairly high. My father didn't want me to fail because everybody else will ask him this question. I think, you know, we should move away from that mode. I think certainly 2017 is far different from 1991 when I started to become an entrepreneur. But whenever you talk about risk, there's also a reward associated with it. Reward can be stupendous. And before we get to the rewards part of it, is that today, at least, I think the acceptance levels are far higher. In case of T-Hub, for instance, after 18 months, we actually give certificate to people who wanted to, who don't have their companies going forward, saying that they were entrepreneurs in residence at T-Hub. It actually gives on the headline, on JNTU, gives this JNTU, which is Jawaharlal Nehru Technical University, gives a certificate to them saying that they were entrepreneurs in residence at T-Hub after they start saying the venture is not going forward. But what we think from the corporate world, that the failures, there's also good learnings out of failures. I keep saying, Yutin, even a company, we celebrate failures. I reframe it, it's we celebrate learnings from failures. But then you look at the, when you have risk, there is also a reward associated with it. There can't be any better example than mine. So I, pardon me with disclosure, it's my example, so I'll share what the reward was. I started in 1991 with four engineers in my modest home on my dining table. That's where the story starts. The initial investment was 20 lakhs of my personal money. Two friends of mine from United States gave me two $10,000 checks. Rupee was 25 rupees a dollar. So it was 2.5 lakhs for each one of them. That's the equity. 25 lakhs of rupees is what I started this company. 97 lakhs is what I borrowed those days from IDBI Venture Capital. Fast forward 26 years, but this is a 25-year-old story is what I keep telling people, is that we now have 14,000 engineers across the world. From those four engineers who came from my neighborhood, we employ 34 different nationalities of people in 28 countries across the world. So far, we did about $2.5 billion worth of foreign exchange earning. We have 1,000 crores of cash in the bank. We don't have debt in the books of balance sheet. People, we were equitable to our investors. I took the company public in 1997, March 20th, 1997. We celebrated the 20th year after we went public on March 20th, 2017. An investor who invested a lakh of rupees in our company, we created value for him at 297 lakhs in 20 years. So money multiplied by 300 times. But pardon me, the company has a $1 billion market cap. You could just understand what the 25 lakhs has become now. So therefore, the rewards are very, very high. Take those risks. You have a reward waiting for you. But one thing I want to tell you, so many things have changed in our lives. I talked all about the company, but including one of the other things that has changed in my life is I keep saying I used to have fairly good amount of hair on my head. That's all disappeared. No regrets at all. One thing hasn't changed with us. Our values have not changed. We keep saying values first, F-I-R-S-T. That's the fundamental principle through which our foundations have been built for the company. What does F-I-R-S-T stand for? Fairness, respect, integrity, sincerity, and trust. These five haven't changed to us, on which we had four pillars of strength to us. The four pillars being our investors, our customers, our employees, and finally the society. We paid back to the society. A CSR work that we have done last year, which earned me, I believe, a Padma Award this year, was that it impacted, this is to do with digital learning, 20,000 children and 40,000 common citizens every year. That's what we have done. So you need to pay back to the society too. What do I conclude by saying is the last number that I read was there are 197 unicorns in the world. 10 of them, I'm sure most of you are familiar, if all of you are familiar with the word called unicorns. There are people who built $1 billion companies, $1 billion market cap companies in 24 months or 36 months. Out of which 10 of them come from India. So which means there are 5% of the people come from India. But the shining eyes and the smiling faces I see in front of me makes me believe that many of you have potential to become unicorns. God bless you and thank you very much. Thank you.
But now I would like to invite Mr. Prateek Shukla for his talk.
Hi guys, it's been a great pleasure to be here. Last time when I was here, I still remember that I was in my first year. For a considerable period of time when I was here, I was doing ding dong on the stage on someone else's performance. So it's a great pleasure to be here. And when I was during my college time, I think ESL was not that big, and the kind of event that we used to conduct at that period of time, it was not that big. This has achieved a massive scale in last couple of years, and I think it's a nice job by all the people, those who are conducting it. Before starting about my journey of GrabHouse, I want to know, like, how many people are here from IIT Kanpur? Oh, that's a considerable amount of people. So I'll introduce myself. I am Prateek. I did my BTech. Graduated in 2012. I entered into Y8 batch. I am from Hall 2. Okay, and I am not hearing any sound from Hall 2 guys. So I am supposedly they are banned from here as well. No. Okay, so but yeah, I am from Hall 2, proud to be a Hall 2 guy. I started, I start my journey about GrabHouse, but before that, I think this event was supposed to be a fireside chat with me and one of my good friend and junior, Farid, but he missed his flight, so he was not here. Probably we'll be doing it tomorrow, and we'll be speaking more about what to do in IIT Kanpur to start up. Today, it's all about GrabHouse journey, okay? And when I was in my fourth year of college, at that point of time, it was like nobody knows anything about startup, okay? We were clueless, everyone was clueless that what is startup all about. There was this only guy from my batch who had like a lot of guts to start up in college itself, to skip the placement in fourth year. His name is Sahil Bagla. He started Blue Gape from college itself. Okay, but rest of us were clueless that what is startup all about. I was basically during the seventh semester, which is like usually a placement semester. At that point of time, I was very confident that I'll be getting placed in on day one or day two, because I had like really great position of responsibilities in my resume and extracurricular activities. But I had something which is very bad, which was CPI. Okay, so my CPI was 6.8 at that point of time, and I was confident, like overconfident, that I'll be getting placed on day one or day two in some consulting firm. So I had not prepared for APTE test and other things, and I was like only confident about solving case studies, and that is the only way I can, like, that is the only thing which I was preparing for. So day one, day two passed, and I was not able to, like, nobody shortlisted me also. Forget about getting placed, I was not even shortlisted. And that was like a heartbreaking moment during IIT Kanpur when you thinking that you can crack it, and you had like one of the best POR and extracurriculars in your resume, but still you are not able to do it. So during that time, Sahil had already started Blue Gape, and he asked me that if I can join him as a core team member. I told him like I'll just wait for some time, like I'll finish 8th semester and then after that I'll decide. Obviously I knew that after 8th semester I can't ask money from my parents. They are not going to give it. And they'll ask me to basically this is the final lot of money which you are getting in April month. After that you're not going to get anything. So you are on your own. And that's the time when I thought that I need to do something before even thinking that I'll end up into consulting job and all. So I joined them. It's a very nice experience. We worked there day and night for four and a half, five months. We were working on all sorts of problems, like creating a new product line. The startup name was bluegape.com. I think some of you might have heard about it. It's not there in the market now, but yeah, it was started during that period. We had raised a couple of rounds of funding also while we were graduating, or they had raised money and I joined them. During those 4.5-5 months, I used to talk to one of my friend, Pankhuri, okay? She was based out of Bombay. She used to tell me that there are so many problems related to apartment hunting in metro cities. And there are brokers in metro cities, those who charge hefty amount of brokerage for not providing any sort of services. So if anybody like over here is from a tier one or tier one cities, they might know that there are brokers, real estate brokers in every city, and they don't actually give you that sort of a service for the kind of money that they charge. They charge usually one and a half month of brokerage, which is like a considerable amount for any particular person. And during that time, I actually used to think that 15 years back, there was a similar industry in India, and most of you might not know about it, but there are a couple of people, you can ask your parents, that during that time, 15 years back, there were, just like how Kirana stores are available nowadays, at that point of time, there were travel agents. Everywhere there were travel agents, there was no website, there was nothing, and they used to book tickets, airline tickets or railway tickets, okay? And that particular market was disrupted by Make My Trip in India. Especially. So during that time when Pankhuri used to tell me about this particular problem, I used to think that there could be a technological solution around it, and this is mainly an information asymmetry and information symmetry game. So basically, like if you'll connect two people over internet and if you can verify them then and there itself, you can get the rental agreement done then and there itself. So there's no problem. So it's basically a transparency related problem, and it can be solved very easily through technology. And that was the idea which was coming, like which was going on into my mind. And because of that, I resigned from Blue Gape. I quit Blue Gape, and I thought that I have learned enough in 4.5-5 months about startup, which I knew nothing 1 year back. And I can start up. So that's when I moved to Bombay. And once again, I had a discussion with my dad that this is what I want to do. And he told me that, I don't know like what have you studied over there and what kind of person you are. You are not going for a job and you're not doing any sort of thing, and you're thinking of and coming up with new and new ideas. But he eventually gave me 30K. He told me ki, this is all the money that you can get, and you can start up. If this money will be over, then you need to basically go back to job, or you need to start working in some serious business. So that's when I basically went to Bombay. 30K lasted for one and a half months, that's it. But yeah, I struggled a lot during that period. It was January 2013. then around July, around April, May 2013, we came to know about this opportunity called India Quotient, which is a very big seed fund. They are organizing boot camp for the very first time in Bombay for 15 they'll be selecting 15 startups, okay, and they'll eventually fund one or two of them if they like their progress. And that's when we thought that this might be our chance. So we applied over there, we got selected, we were like 15, we were among those 15 teams, those who got selected. Basic reason for getting selected and why we were happy, it's not because we can have a chance of getting funded, but because it was like a 49 days incubation program where you can get place to sleep, where you can get like completely air conditioned office, where you can get coffee unlimited, where you can sometime get food also, and that's all free of cost. In a city like Bombay, that is like too much. Okay, that is something which is like 50K or 60K, usually if you'll spend on that kind of money, and you'll get a very good Wi-Fi, just like IITK. So we took that opportunity. We graduated from IQ Bootcamp, and none of the companies out of 15 companies got funding during that time. So we thought that, chalo, theek hai, it's okay, let's try for something else, let's start build, like, let's keep on building our product, let's get some traction and all those kind of thing. And after a month or two, IQ people were continuously following our traction, and then they told us ki we want to invest in you guys. And that was the first time when we actually and it was the time when you were not desperately looking for money, as in like you were looking for money, but you are not asking for the money from someone and someone is giving it to you. And that is the first moment of realization that we are doing something which is like really, really working well, and that's why people are actually interested. And that's the time when we got funding. We had raised our first round, which was around 60 lakhs. and during that time, after that, we started building on product. And but like, for most of you, those who don't know about how this startup industry works, seed funding is something which you can get very easily when you have a good team and a very nice business opportunity which have a considerable market size. Okay, so it's not that difficult if you'll go in the market to raise seed fund. It's very difficult to raise Series A when you are when you don't have a like proper revenue model or you're not showing traction. So seed round is not that difficult. And it was not difficult for us also. But after that, when we were, during that time when we were building our product, so at that point of time, we thought that we might be in a good position to raise Series A. So at that point of time, we started charging our customers. So if you remember what I just told you, that Grabhouse was like connecting owner to tenant directly, and we were not charging any fees for the starting 1 year. And after that, when we were thinking that we have a considerable amount of growth, we started charging from customers that we'll charge you a small fee for connecting you to the right owner. And people started paying. And that's the time when we raised our Series A funding from Kalari Capital and Sequoia Capital. Okay, it was $2.5 million round. and things were going very smoothly. During that time, we were like one of the fastest growing startup. We were mentioned everywhere and all those kind of things have happened. And it was December 2014 when we had finally closed our Series A and we got the money in our bank account. We had our first board meeting in March 2015. That's when our board had decided that we should invest more money in this company. We are now growing so fast that we should raise Series B also. So at that point of time, in just a span of 3 months, we got Series B funding, which is around $8.5 million at that point of time from Kalari and Sequoia. And it was like, in just 3 months, your valuation is like 10 times than your previous valuation. And it has, like, we don't know like what is going on and what is favoring us and why we are growing so fast and why all the things are working in our favor. And that's the time when things have started falling apart. Okay, so that's the time when we had gone crazy in terms of hiring people. We had hired like really, really smart people. We had built our team from 50 member to 300 member in just a span of 3 months. Okay, so we were growing crazy in terms of growth. But since the growth was not happening up to the level that we were expecting, we started throwing people on problems. As in, like, this is a problem which is existing. Let's, like, if it is not getting solved through technology, let's create a call center team and all those kind of things. So that is something which we had started doing, which is completely opposite to the idea how we started GrabHouse. Okay. And during that time, there were a couple of smart engineers in our team who came up with an idea that, Prateek, our tech stack and architecture is not that good. It's like monolithic and it's not that appropriate at all. So we thought, let's change it. So they proposed a microservice architecture, and they told us that we'll create a SOA and all those kind of thing. And at that point of time, I thought that, but like, if you have raised Series B, a very important person in Sequoia told me that before Series B, people consider you as a kid. Okay, people don't want to argue with you. People always always understand whatever you are trying to say. But as soon as you raise Series B and the amount hit into your account, that's the time when people think that you are changed from a boy to a man. Okay, and that's the time when they start, when they expect a lot of seriousness from you. And although, since it has happened in a span of 3 months, so we were not ready for it, and we had raised that kind of money, and that has, because of that, and our tech team had decided to shift our entire tech architecture. So we had all the more reasons to hire more people to basically throw it on the problems. And by December 2015, we were a team of 350 people. Okay, and that's the time when we realized that we are burning around 2.5-3 crores a month, and not getting any sort of output out of it. As in, we are just having a team of smart people, those who are doing every sort of work, but it is not getting channelized into one particular thing that we decided. And we also pivoted from our earlier business model to a new business model that. We'll be creating a fully furnished houses for all the bachelors, okay? So, but in December 2015, we got a clear instruction that this, if you are going to grow like this, you are going to be doomed. So very soon, and irrespective of the kind of money that you have raised. So we had to do a layoff, which was like a really, for a first time founder, doing a layoff of 150 people is something which is very difficult, very, very difficult. You have to go, like, you guys have not experienced that sort of a thing. Even firing a junior over here in a team is something which is difficult. Just imagine those 150 people, those who are in your team, and you want to let go of them. But we were, like, obviously the ship was sinking, but we thought that we can change it by bringing IIT Kanpur people. That's the final nail to the coffin. So we actually hired 23 IIT Kanpur batchmates, like my batchmates. Okay, I called 23 people from my batch and my junior batch and asked them to join us, because it's a sinking ship, and you are the problem solvers and you can only solve it. So although those, like, we were very late in terms of bringing those people. They are like really smart people. But obviously, we were burning around 2.5 crore rupees. After laying off, we bought it down to 1.5, like around a crore. But then again, we hired 23 really smart people, and we had to pay them. And that's when, like, overall, if you'll see, the burn rate has not actually gone anywhere, as in it was similar. And then, so it was continuously going, and we, this is how it was going till August 2016, when we basically came to know that one of our competitors have raised $30 million, and they are doing 10x more revenue than us. So, and we had around 20 crores in our bank account. So we thought that, that's the time when I had to take a logical call that with this 20 crore, can I basically, with this smart team and 20 crores in our bank account, can I build that kind of a company which can reach up to 15x or 20x of the revenue that we are doing right now, comparable to our competitor, and then we'll be able to raise another round of funding, or we should basically let it go and merge it with some larger company for the betterment of employees, for the betterment of shareholders, for the betterment of the entire company. Because obviously it was an emotional decision, but I had to take this logical call that with 20 crores, you can either spend it just like how you are spending since now, till that particular period, and you can you can be like, you can shut down the company, or you can merge it with some larger player and try to achieve those kind of things, try to achieve that vision that on the basis of which you had founded this company. So that's the time when we started exploring merger opportunities. We finally merged GrabHouse with Quikr in November 2016, and that's the time when we were doing around 45 lakhs per month revenue. We were not profitable, we were burning around a crore per month. At this point, GrabHouse, the metric of August in GrabHouse was, we were doing 2.98 crores of revenue with one third of the team that we had, and GrabHouse is profitable. Okay, so basically, merging it with the company, merging it with Quikr was an appropriate decision for the team. The team is still there. There are my batchmate Zuzu is still there. And we are actually working on our vision. We have made it profitable also, and we have actually made it a business, like a proper business. As in, earlier we were just running on external funding, and we were not looking at it like a business. We were like really young to think about it as a not like startup is in the end a business, and we were really immature, and that is how most of the entrepreneurs are actually. And the reason for Fireside Chat, why I agreed, is because this is a great opportunity which you get in this college, which you had to understand during your time over here, and that is something which you realize while going into the real world. So like, I agreed for this Fireside Chat because I wanted you guys to understand that what are the traits, what are the qualities that you can build up over here with small things, and that can lead to something which is not as like you'll not make much mistakes. Like, you'll make obviously mistakes, but you'll not make the kind of mistakes that I did. And overall, I don't consider GrabHouse as a failure. I think like we have learned a lot. We have made some money also. And overall, it was a fun experience. First time starting up and raising money from such a nice people. And eventually help them in order to like help the company to become a profitable company. So that's how, that's what GrabHouse journey is all about. I think, if you guys have any sort of questions, I would love to answer them, or we can do it tomorrow as well if there would be a Fireside Chat. Any questions, anything? Nothing? Still confused? Okay, no worries. I think that's about it. Thank you so much for having me here. Most probably I would love to see some people tomorrow. Cool, thank you.
We hope that the crowd assembled here must have not only enjoyed your talk, and they must have definitely learned something from it too.
Now I would like to invite Dr. Indraneel Manna, Dr. B.V. Fani to present memento of thanks and token of appreciation to our guest. Now I would first like to call upon on stage Dr. B.V.R. Mohan Reddy. Now I would like to call Mr. Sanjeev Agrawal on stage. and Shivam Rastogi to present memento of thanks to Dr. Indraneel Manna.
Funny sir,
I am to present mementos to Dr. B.V. Funny.
अब अपनी फोटो अच्छी आएगी इस बर्थडे को.
Tomorrow session, we would like to give some highlights. There are some entrepreneur opportunities in core sector at 12 p.m. here itself in the main auditorium. And the panel discussion with people who have made it to Forbes 30 under 30 list with theme as solving problems that no one has ever solved it before would be held at 7 p.m.
For further details, please check on to the Facebook page of ecel.iit Kanpur. I would like to thank the wonderful audience and hope that you enjoyed the session. Good night, everyone.